Welcome to Rightful United Methodist.
Good morning. Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So glad to have you join us here at Rightful United Methodist Church. My name is Doug Lane, and I'm senior pastor here. Hope you're having a great week. It's a little chilly outside this morning, and with that in mind, we're actually going to be going outside to Bannerman Vineyard in Burgall, North Carolina. You'll see why as we get closer to the time of our scripture and sermon. You'll see that there's a connection with the vineyard with today's story. As always, there's a lot going on in the life of the church, and I want to promote just a couple of those things right now. One of the things that we're looking at this month as part of our Vision 2020 emphasis is joining a small group or joining a class. And I hope that you will take that seriously. If you're not already in a Bible study or a Sunday school class or some type of small group, reach out to our Director of Spiritual Formation, Donna Pinckney. You can find her at donna@rightsvilleumc.org. And one of the classes that's going to be coming up in October is a class that I'm going to be teaching called Disciple Bible Study. Disciple looks at the grand sweep of the Bible over about a 9-month period. I'd love to have you be a part of that class. And again, just reach out to Donna in order to register. And a way to serve this week is to help the families who are served by Family Promise. Family Promise is a charity that takes place right here in Wilmington that helps families that are temporarily displaced. These are men and women and children who do not have a permanent home, and usually they stay in different churches around the Wilmington area. Well, because of COVID, they're not staying in different churches. They do have a place where they can stay, and their Family Promise has invited us to help with some meals over the next couple of weeks. No, we're not going to actually cook. Again, because of the COVID issue, but we're going to send in some gift cards, and if you'd like to help, you can just write out a check to Rightful United Methodist Church and put on the 4-line Family Promise. As always, you can give to your church through the mail, and our address is Post Office Box 748, Rightful Beach, North Carolina, 28480, or you can go to our website, rightsvilleumc.org, and click on the Giving tab, or you can give through our app. Lots of different ways that you can give. Anyway, hope you're going to have a great week, and I hope that you'll be inspired by today's worship service and our time together. We look forward to the opportunity to be able to be together physically. Hopefully that's going to happen really, really soon. We keep praying. I know that you are as well. But right now, I'm going to invite you to stop, get out your phone, and pass the peace of Christ among our friends. And so just type in a friend. They can be a church member. They don't have to be a church member. But just let them know, may the peace of Christ be with you. And with that, I hope the peace of Christ will be with you today. Thank you.
Sing alleluia to the Lord.
Sing alleluia to the Lord.
Sing alleluia.
Good morning. I invite you to join me in our opening prayer. Gracious God, who invites us, who calls us to work in your vineyard, invite us in this day. Help us to work alongside you, to bring love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Help us to harvest righteousness, peace, and truth. When we are weary, when we are resentful, looking beside us instead of at the goal of your kingdom, focus our eyes again on you. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen. And now I invite you to join us in our opening hymn. The words will be found on your screen.
September's scripture is Psalm 103, verses 1 through 13. Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, boys and girls. It's time for children's time, and I invite you to come closer to the screen so that we can have our time together. I want to talk to you today about kingdoms, and just trying to think of what kind of things I might have that would help us think about kingdoms. And I came up with one thing. We don't have many kingly looking things around, but I found this. Do you see this? It's a mug from England, and it's of King Henry VIII. And so that was something to sort of remind me of kingdoms from England. There's a queen in England now that's called Queen Elizabeth. Maybe you've heard of her before. But our scripture lesson today that Pastor Doug is going to talk to us about is talking about the way Jesus said God's kingdom is. And God's kingdom is very different from what people might think of on this earth. Maybe you've had a day, your birthday perhaps, when someone has said to you that you can be king or queen for the day and get anything you want and do whatever you want within reason. And maybe you get to pick your favorite food, or you get to pick your favorite TV show or a video or something like that. Well, that's one way of thinking of kingdoms. But Jesus taught us some different ways. And over the next few weeks, we're going to hear about those ways of thinking of God's kingdom. And God's kingdom is very, very different. One of the things that we know about God's kingdom is that God is generous and loving to all people, and very, very often blesses us. In other words, pours out things to us, not things, but blessings, giving us parents who love us, teachers who love us, pastors who love us. But God blesses us with more than we would deserve. So instead of thinking that we're going to get punished, for example, maybe God forgives us and does something really wonderful and very tender and caring for us. That's a way of looking at the way God does with us. God is sovereign. That means God is king of the universe. And if we understand that God is king of the universe, and that we serve him, and that he is loving and kind and so very good to all of us, we can think of all of the ways that he blesses us instead of thinking of a king that demands to get everything his way. So let's say a prayer together and watch for ways that God blesses us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are King of this universe. You are King of our lives, and we want to please you. Help us to watch for your blessings, to thank you for the ways that you just pour out so many ways of showing your love for us. Thank you for Jesus. Help us to follow him and bless these children in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. We'll see you next week. Bye.
This is our time in our service in which we lift up our prayers to God, the cries of our hearts and our needs. We continue to lift up all of those who are experiencing natural disasters. We specifically remember those out in the West, in California and Oregon and Colorado especially, who are dealing with wildfires and smoke, and also those on the Gulf Coast who are living in the aftermath of Hurricane Sally. It has seemed relentless this year. For our prayer, I will be drawing on a prayer from a website called Liturgies for Parents. And although it is a a site that provides prayers for parents. I think it can apply to all of us who need to be parented by God. And so now I invite you to pray with me. Our world is burning, O God. Fires keep spreading, and no matter how much we stop, drop, and roll, we can't seem to temper the flames around us. Our world is burning, O God. The air is thick with smoke, and we can't catch our breath. We keep rubbing our eyes, but we can't see past the haze. Our world is burning, O God. We don't know how to raise our children when everything is hot to the touch and the winds keep blowing, igniting the fires from every direction. Our world is burning, O God, and we can't even seem to agree on what is causing the fires, let alone on how to fight them and forge a new way forward. Our world is burning, O God, and we need your living water. Especially for those people, those situations that we pause and name before you now. O Lord, hear our prayer. Our world is burning, O God, and we need your living water to sustain us for this day and forevermore. Refresh our hearts and our systems that the fires have refined. O God, help us to clear a new path and begin again. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus, our Savior and our friend. And we pray as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. It is our gift to be able to work alongside God, to work in God's vineyard, God's kingdom, by giving. And so we invite you to give. There will be three different ways to give that are highlighted on the screen as you listen to our offering. And now I invite you to give generously as you can to the God who gives generously to us.
Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Nobody.
Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We're glad that you're joining us with our worship service here with Wrightsville United Methodist Church. Today we're in Bergall, or Bergall, as my wife says, and she's from this area, so I'm sure she's pronouncing it right and I'm mispronouncing it. We're at Bannerman Vineyards near Bergall, and the grapes are ready to be picked. So we've really been grateful for their hospitality to us as we hear today's scripture about the workers in the vineyard and the Bannerman's willingness to let us come out here and be able to record today's sermon. Let's hear this scripture again. It's Matthew chapter 20, beginning in verse 1. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I'll pay you whatever is right." So they went, and when he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one's hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." And when evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." And when those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only an hour, and you've made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I'm doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I'm generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I got to start with a confession. I kind of hate this parable. I mean, I really do. After doing several different series throughout the summer, I open up the lectionary to see what has been assigned for this week, and this is the parable that we get? I mean, really? Why don't I like this parable? Well, mainly because I've been in church all my life. You know who does like this parable? People who haven't been in church all their lives, and people who know, love, and care for people who haven't been in church all their lives. It's a fantastic parable for them. And I know I should be a bigger person, more gracious, more generous, magnanimous even. And sure enough, as I reread this parable, I realized the intended listener to Jesus' story isn't someone who's experiencing grace and forgiveness and acknowledging it late in life. Rather, this story is for all of us who have known God for most, if not all, our lives. This story is meant for us. Let's look at it again. And I want to start with maybe using a more modern perspective. An accounting firm is having its best year since it was founded 10 years ago. It's now April 14th, and the owner of the accounting firm wonders if she's taken on too many projects, so she decides to bring in some extra help. A friend had mentioned a temp agency in town that was very reliable. She Googles the name, locates the number, and makes the call. The nervous woman breathes a sigh of relief when she learns that they do have someone available to help her. She says, "My going rate is $100 a day. Is that acceptable?" The temp agency says, "Sure." The next day, the temp worker arrives and the accountant puts him to work closing out projects. At the first coffee break, however, the lady knows that they're still in trouble even with this additional help. So she phones the temp agency again, and they say they have another worker that they could send over immediately. The temp agency says, yeah. We realize, of course, that you're going to prorate the wage based on how long the person works, but the accountant doesn't actually respond to that in the conversation. So the second worker arrives and joins the other temp on closing out projects. They're doing the same job, pushing calculators, typing figures, submitting returns, and now it's lunchtime. The lady knows she's still in deep trouble. She's not going to be able to get all this done. So she calls the temp agency a third time and asks for another worker, which they send over. And again, assuming there's going to be a prorated fee. Finally, late in the day, realizing she's going to have one more worker, she says, "Do you have anybody else you can send over for just an hour?" They do. And soon, the last worker arrives. They all finish at exactly 5 o'clock. She calls all the temp workers into the office and thanks them profusely for the work that they've done that day. She is so grateful for all their work. And then she begins with the person that worked only the last hour, and she hands them a crisp $100 bill. She then gives the same to all the other workers, including the one who worked all day long. Well, the first worker, is starting to do a slow burn, right? At this point, tapping his feet and staring at the ceiling, he waits until everyone else has left, and then he confronts the accountant. He says, "How could you pay everyone else the same thing that you paid me? I put in a full 8 hours, the second person put in 6, the third put in 4, the fourth only worked an hour, and you paid them the same that you paid me? That's not fair. I deserve more." Now, it was the accountant's turn to do a slow burn. She stood up, walked across the room, got nose to nose with this temp, and said, "Am I really being unfair? Really? Isn't this my company? Isn't this my money? Can I not spend my money the way I see fit? Did we not agree that you would make $100 for the day? Maybe your problem isn't with your payment. Maybe it's with my generosity." Well, the story I just told is obviously based on the story that Jesus told in the Gospel of Matthew. It's got to be one of the most difficult parables that Jesus ever told because it strikes at the very heart of what we here in America have always been taught. We've been taught things like equal pay for equal work. We've been taught demand your rights or insist on getting what you deserve. Yet Jesus tells a story to illustrate that those principles don't work exactly that way in the kingdom of God. If this story were to happen today, unions would go on strike. The AFL-CIO would be railing for a federal investigation. The Better Business Bureau would go into overdrive. The air would be thick with lawsuits. But as we get into this story, you begin to understand why that is. For this parable has long been called the parable of the workers in the vineyard. This assumes that the workers are the focus of the parable. The thing is, they're really not. The focus of the parable is not the employee, but the employer. As we study this parable, keep this in mind. Jesus tells us in verse 1 that this is what the kingdom of heaven is like. God's world is not like our world, and God's ways are not like our ways. When you first read this story, you'll probably think the same thing that I thought. Well, that ain't fair. Here is a staggering truth. The kingdom of God is not fair. And the God of the kingdom is not fair. But don't turn off your video just yet. Stay with me, okay? And let me explain. For the kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for a denarius a day, he sent them into the vineyard. Now, harvest time came once a year in Israel. The soil was prepared in the spring, the vines were pruned in the summer, and about this time of year, it was time to harvest the grapes. Now, back in those days, there were no labor unions and no employment offices. They didn't use LinkedIn or Indeed.com in order to find work. Instead, in every little village and town, there'd be a place called an agora, or a marketplace. And usually, there would be one particular place where common, ordinary laborers and workers would come gather, hoping to be hired for the day. These workers were the lowest on the social ladder. They were just hoping and praying to get hired each day. They were not regularly hired by anybody. They didn't hold down a steady job. They didn't have the benefits of continual employment. They just worked one day at a time, hoping that somebody would hire them. And for them, life was pretty simple. If they didn't work that day, they didn't eat. And neither did their wife and kids. So it was here that the owner of the vineyard would come, and he would seek to hire these day workers who would work at the daily going rate, one day at a time, giving them the opportunity to put food on the table. These first workers would have been hired around 6 in the morning. Verse 1 tells us that they entered into a binding oral agreement for what pay they would use for the work that they would give. Now, the word for agreement in the Greek is the same word that gives us the English word symphony. It's a legal term, sure, but it also infers that each party has their part to play in order to reach the mutually agreed upon goal. The first worker agrees to work a full day, and they would make a denarius, which was the equivalent of a day's wage for an average worker, or basically the minimum wage. Later, another kind of worker would be hired. These will be hired later in the day, but this time there's no verbal agreement. They don't actually know what they're going to be paid. They're simply told in verse 4, "Whatever is right, I will give you." Now, some workers began at the crack of dawn, working for an agreed upon wage, and some workers came in later, not knowing what they were going to make, just happy to receive anything. However, all of these workers have one thing in common. The master didn't have to hire any of them. He could have gone to another town. He could have gone to another marketplace. He could have hired totally different people. He could have hired no one. He was under no obligation at all to hire any of these individuals. He was gracious to have invited any of them to make money that day. Well, it's now the political season once again in 2020, and we're going to be inundated with ads for candidates over the next 6 weeks. And recently, I came across a story about one of our former presidents, Calvin Coolidge. Apparently, Coolidge was a man of very few words. His nickname was Silent Cal. And yet, even though he didn't say very much, when he did speak, it was often funny. He was known for his dry wit. Well, before Coolidge became president of the United States, he was elected mayor of Northampton, Massachusetts. It's a small town, it was a close race, and he only won by a few votes. Well, the day after he won, he's walking down the street, and a friend came up to him who was in the opposite political party, trying to just dig him a little bit. He said, "Calvin, I read in the paper this morning where you were elected mayor, and you won by just a few votes. I just wanted to let you know that I didn't vote for you." Calvin never broke stride. He just looked over and said, "Well, somebody did." Coolidge's point was that nobody had to vote for him, but he was grateful for the ones who did. And enough voted for him so that he won. God didn't have to vote for us. God didn't have to invite us to become part of his family. God didn't have to call us to partner with him in ministry. We are told throughout the scriptures that the only reason God did any of these things is because of grace. Thanks be to God. There were two young men that were talking one time, and one man said to the other one, "Why did you choose Jennifer for a girlfriend?" And he said, "Well, because Jennifer is different from any girl I've ever met before." He said, "Well, really? In what way?" He said, "Well, she's the only girl who would agree to go out with me." But I'm bummed.
God doesn't invite anybody to be part of his family, to be a citizen in his kingdom, or to be a worker in his ministry because he has to. He does it because he wants to. He does it out of grace. That's amplified as the story continues. And going out about the third hour, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And to them he said, "You go into the vineyard too, and whatever is right I will give you." So they went. And going out again about the sixth hour and the ninth hour, he did the same. And about the 11th hour, this is a 12-hour workday, he went out and found others standing. And he said to them, "Why do you stand here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You go into the vineyard too." The master gets the first workers around 6 a.m. He comes back at 9 in the morning and hires some more. He comes back at noon and does the same. He comes back at 3 and then comes back finally at 5 and hires some workers, even though sundown is approaching and they can't possibly work very long and they certainly can't be very productive. In fact, anybody that knows anything about business knows that the later in the day, as it went on, the more reason there was not to hire anybody else, particularly if you had to hire them at the going rate, because you'd be getting the least bang for your buck. Remember even more that these men did not get a job because they were looking for work. They got a job because the owner was looking for workers and willing to give them a job. Allow me to reiterate, these men had no steady employment. They were utterly dependent on an employer who was willing to hire them at any point, for any period of time, for any wage. They're totally dependent on the grace of the employer. No master was under any legal obligation to hire anybody at all. There were plenty of workers for the master to hire, so any worker that was chosen should simply be grateful that the master chose them. The point is, every worker, regardless of when they are hired, should simply be grateful that the master is gracious enough to hire them. It's easy to find ourselves in this parable, I think. In fact, we can find ourselves pretty much in every snapshot of the kingdom that Jesus tells us about. It's obvious we are the workers in the parable, and God is the master. We are the employees, and God is the employer. This is a snapshot of the kingdom of God and the God of the kingdom. And this is where the story begins to get both fascinating and, I'll admit, also a little infuriating. And when evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Call the laborers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last up to the first." And the owner calls all the workers together to give them their wage. The first surprise here is that the people who came to work last are the ones who are paid first. You know, normally people who would come to work first would get paid first. But bucking custom, he purposely pays the last workers first. As you're going to see, he does this for a reason. He wants the first workers to know what the last workers are getting paid. And in this comes a bit of a shock. And when those hired about the 11th hour came, each of them received a denarius. Amazingly, the workers who were hired at 5 o'clock in the afternoon are paid a full day's wage. Well, word begins to spread around the rest of the workers, right? Everybody's getting out their calculators. If the guy that worked for an hour got paid a denarius, then those who worked for 12 hours might get 12 denariuses, denarii. They're thinking they might get 2 weeks' pay for one day's work? Sweet! But then comes shock number two. Now, when those hired first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received a denarius. These early workers can't believe it. They're stunned. They're getting paid exactly the same amount for 12 hours labor that other people got paid for one. Come on now. That ain't right. Did it really say that? You see why I don't like this parable? It's not fair. The thing is, the workers who worked all day got exactly what they had bargained for in the first place, and exactly what both parties had agreed to. You can guess the response. And on receiving it, they grumbled at the master of the house, saying, these last worked only an hour, and you've made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat. Immediately they screamed out, unfair! We worked longer. We deserve more. We should get a bigger paycheck. Notice, this is not the cry of the underpaid. No one's actually underpaid in this parable. This is the cry of the ungrateful. They had made the fatal mistake of comparing what they got with what someone else had. And when you start comparing, then you start coveting. And when you start coveting, you start complaining. And instead of being grateful for what God has given you, you start to grumble about what God has given someone else. Now we see why the owner paid the men in reverse order. If he'd paid the first workers first and let them go on their way, nobody would have been any wiser. Nobody would have known. But the owner wanted everyone to know both how gracious he was and how generous he was. His response takes us to the heart of this parable. The fairness principle says equal pay for equal work, but the father's principle is equal grace for equal need. Every single worker was given a job because of grace. They didn't get a job because they deserved it. They got a job in spite of the fact that they didn't. Think about this. You didn't even deserve to be born. Everything you have, including your very life, is something you have because of the grace of God. That is why there simply is no room for jealousy in God's kingdom or in God's family. We ought to be glad that God is gracious to us. We ought to be glad that God is so generous, not just to us, but to everybody else. Do you see the lessons that come out of this parable? Do you understand why, when it comes to God and the way He relates to us, that it's really all about grace? God is different. God is holy. And God invites us to be holy too, to also be different, to be generous, to be extravagant, to be gracious, to be magnanimous. So here are our takeaways. Number one, God doesn't owe us anything. Deep down, some of us think that He does. Sure, He owes me. I go on mission trips. I sing in the choir. I'm a nice guy. I don't break the law. I work hard. I give my offerings. And then we grumble about what we don't have. Let me put it this way. How many of you perfectly obey every law of the state at all times? You always come to a complete stop at every stop sign, even when nobody else is around. You never go 1 mile an hour over the speed limit, ever. You always use your turn signals. You always obey the traffic laws. None of us does that every time, right? But suppose you did. Would the government send you a check every month in gratitude for what you've done? I don't think so. You only did what you were supposed to do. Likewise, God doesn't owe us anything for what we do for Him. We should do it for Him because we're glad He's so gracious to us. Lesson number two. We can't earn anything from God. Everything we have from God, whether it is eternal life or even a reward in this life, is simply because of His grace. God does not pay us what we deserve. God gives us what we don't deserve. You'll notice this parable has two bookends. The last verse of Matthew 19 is the first bookend. But many who are first will be last, and the last first. And then the last verse in this parable is the other bookend. So the last will be first, and the first last. Jesus told us this story to illustrate the truth of His upside-down kingdom. The first shall be last, and the last shall be first. How can one who finishes last be first? How can one who finishes first be last? That can only happen if the judge rules that they cross the finish line at the same time. That is, if they're both seen exactly the same way, that both are in need of God's grace. The man comes home to his wife and his kids, and he puts a denarius down on the table. His wife comes up to him and hugs him and says, "Thank God you had work today. We were running out of food and you came through. I know you must be exhausted." And the man says, "Well, actually, not really. I only worked an hour." The wife looks at him with a puzzled expression. She says, "That's a full day's wage. How did you get that when you only worked for an hour?" The man says, "Beats me. I just know I got hired at 5 o'clock. I worked 1 hour, and the owner paid me the same thing that he paid the man that started at 6 in the morning. The wife looks at him and says, "You got way more than you deserved." And the man says with a broad smile on his face, "Don't we all? Look at everything you have. Not just materially, but relationally, socially, physically, our health, what we have, our family, our friends, our home, our place in this world, our place in God's kingdom. Let's look at what we have had. Let's look at what will be. Isn't it all by the grace of God? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen." Today, let's take a moment to just thank God for His love and grace, for our salvation, for everything that we have in this life. It all belongs to God anyway, and He has given us this life to share with Him, to love Him back, and to love others as we love ourselves. Go forth in peace, and may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.